good morning. Hope you all are doing well on this 4th of July Sunday. Our desire is to come together and worship Christ. Last Sunday, Brent alluded to the first time that believers were called Christians, because people said, what are we going to call this diverse group of people coming together? And they were first called Christians at Antioch. So our first song this morning includes that idea of welcome. Come, Christians. All who are underneath Jesus Christ is the only way of salvation. Would you join and stand to sing with us? Alleluia. Praise the Lord.
Come, Christians, join to sing.
Of independence, we are thankful for the freedom to worship in Christ's name freely today. And our prayer is that we would understand our God is our help today. He has been our help in ages past, and He is our only hope in years to come. We'll speak about that today, but Brent will continue the theme of that. But understanding our trust is in our God alone, as Americans, thanking God for the freedoms that we have. Oh God, our help in ages past. He is our shelter and ultimately our eternal home and our eternal hope. So let's sing this song of praise, O God.
O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter.
Seated. I'll give you a special welcome to our services today. If you are joining us for the first time, or if it's been a while since you joined us in worship, we're glad that you're here. And whether you're here for the first time, or you're a regular attender or member here, we ask that sometime throughout the service, you take the time to fill out a Connect card. It's in the pew in front of you or in your bulletin, and it's an opportunity for you to share prayer requests with the church or with the elders confidentially, for you to let us know what God is doing in your life, and for us to pray with and for you and praise the Lord. So would you take the time to do that sometime throughout the service and drop it in the box at each exit to this building as you leave this morning. We hope that you'll come back, not only for our regular 11:15 hour this morning for prayer and discipleship, but at 5 o'clock today, we'll be having a cookout down on the grounds. Ben Pierce is cooking the food for us, and he has told us there is plenty of food. So please come. Even if you didn't sign up, please come. If you have a guest you'd like to bring, please bring them. It would be a great time of fellowship. We'll begin around 5 o'clock, and we'll continually be serving some food from 5 to 6 or 6:30 or so. So please come. You can bring some softball gloves. We might get a game going. We have some bats and bases upstairs we'll bring down. Frisbee, soccer balls, those kind of things. You're welcome to bring those. And if you signed up to bring a side dish, but you can't remember what you signed up for, Mary Margaret printed that list in the lobby for you as you leave if you want to check on that. So that'll be this afternoon. You all are invited. This coming Wednesday evening, July the 7th, we will meet, for those who are working with Vacation Bible School, we will meet in the Fellowship Hall at 5:45. We'll have some pizza provided for you, and we'll meet just for an hour before our regular equip night for a time of training for Vacation Bible School. If you have not received an email from Mary Margaret about working in VBS and you're not sure if you are, please let us know. If you would like to help and you just want to show up on Wednesday and find a place, that would be fine as well. We'll go through some basic child safety things and some basic overviews for all workers in Vacation Bible School. Again, Vacation Bible School will be the last full week of July, Monday through Thursday evening, 6:30 to 8:30 for kids in kindergarten up through the sixth grade. So the main thing all of you all can do is invite children to come. And if you please invite your neighbors, your friends, people who aren't your friends, strangers, invite them to come. And there are some flyers on the welcome desk as you leave. So this was a late add to our calendar when we realized that we could do Vacation Bible School. So we want to make sure that the word gets out. So invite as many children as you can to come. We will make room for all of them. So that will be the last full week of July. This morning we will have our scripture reading and prayer, some hymns, and then our sermon and communion today as we continue to remember our Savior, Jesus Christ, and meet in his name. Joseph, would you come and read the scripture for us?
Want to recognize Josh Bradford. Where's Josh? Josh, where's Lauren? Oh, there. Okay, good. Josh and Lauren are here as married couple for the first time at UBC. Is that correct? Second time. Well, we weren't there. Okay, good, good. We just wanted to recognize you. Great. 1 Timothy chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5 this morning. We'll read a longer section. We'll read through verse 16. First Timothy 5. 1 through 16. Here the apostle instructs Timothy about the care of widows, something we can learn about God's care for the destitute, for the poor. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 1. Do not rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters in all purity. Honor widows who are truly widows. But if a widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show godliness to their own household and to make some return to their parents. For this is pleasing in the sight of God. She who is truly a widow, left all alone, has set her hope on God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But she who is self-indulgent is dead even while she lives. Command these things as well, so that they may be without reproach. But if anyone does not provide for his relatives, and especially for members of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Let a widow be enrolled if she is not less than 60 years of age, having been the wife of one husband, and having a reputation for good works. If she has brought up children, has shown hospitality, has washed the feet of the saints, has cared for the afflicted, and has devoted herself to every good work, but refused to enroll younger widows. For when their passions draw them away from Christ, they desire to marry, and so incur condemnation for having abandoned their former faith. Besides that, they learn to be idlers, going about from house to house, and not only idlers, but also gossips and busybodies, saying what they should not. So I would have younger widows marry, bear children, manage their households, and give the adversary no occasion for slander. For some have already strayed after Satan. If any believing woman has relatives who are widows, let her care for them. Let the church not be burdened, so that it may care for those who are truly widows. Did you notice here in verses 1 and 2 how the apostle encourages Timothy to consider treating, he says, do not rebuke an older man, but encourage him as you would a father. And then he says, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, this familial connection. We see all throughout the New Testament, we in God's church are brothers, sisters. That's something very appealing even to our international friends to see that dynamic here in our local church. Will you join with me in prayer this morning? Lord, we are grateful to come together as your people bought by your precious blood. You didn't choose us because we are lovely. We are lovely because you have chosen us. You have set your love on us. Lord, we thank you this morning that we can worship here in this country. We have the freedom to gather together and call on your name, the name of the Lord Jesus. You defeated the powers of evil, of death, destruction. And we thank you, Lord, for the heritage of this great country. We pray, Lord, for revival. Lord, we pray that once again your name would be honored, Lord, by many and many people across this land. Lord, thank you for the many who have gone forth as your representatives, as ambassadors around the world, even in my country, India. Lord, thank you for the witness of American Christians. Lord, we pray also for your word around the world, for countries, for nations, for peoples. Lord, we know that one day, according to your plan, there will be Christians from all nations, all tribes. We pray that you would hasten your work among the people groups of the world, that your fame, the glory of your name would be proclaimed. Lord, use us this morning as your people gathered here. May we treasure you. May we long to see your kingdom established. Lord, instill in our children and our grandchildren a desire to see your name lifted high. We pray for Pastor Brent this morning that you would anoint him afresh. Lord, that his words would be your words. Give us sensitivity. Lord, a heart that's ready to receive your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
The next two songs very explicitly and clearly explain the love that the Father had for us in sending his Son Jesus to die. If you are here today and you do not have a relationship with God through Jesus, I encourage you to listen as we sing of the love of Jesus for you, and that the gospel is the story that you, though you're a sinner, can be forgiven of your sin through the work of the cross. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, would you glory in these gospel truths? How deep the Father's love for us, vast beyond all measure, we will never understand or comprehend the greatness of the love of Jesus. Would you stand together as we sing our testimony of Christ?
Sing, why should?
Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my
power of the cross is that sinners can become saints, that enemies of God become his friends, that enemies of one another become brothers and sisters, as Joseph alluded to. Would you glory with me in the gospel of Jesus? Oh, to see the dawn, the power of the cross.
Oh, to see the dawn of the dawn. Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of gold. This the
together.
This the power of the cross.
be seated. UBC kids, up to the first grade, you can be dismissed to the lobby. Your children's workers will meet you there.
Well, today we celebrate the birth of our country. So let's return to the question that we began addressing last week. How do we live as citizens in an earthly kingdom while our ultimate citizenship is in the kingdom of heaven, in the new Jerusalem, in the new earth? I do want to spend some time today talking about the history of our country and how it came to be and how the church responded to the revolution of 1776. A 17th century trickle of immigrants landing in Jamestown in 1607 and Plymouth in 1620 turned into a flood of immigrants in the 18th century. In 1715, the colonial population of America was approximately 350,000. 1715. By 1775, the population had swelled to about 3 million. The population boom moved the colonies increasingly toward political and social self-sufficiency. English-speaking clergy were largely American-educated. Secondary schools had made the colonists the most literate people in the world. More than 40 newspapers circulated through the colonies. The Great Awakening from 1734 through the early 1740s gave colonists for the first time a sense of national unity. The Great Awakening was, in fact, the first event that was experienced by people living in all 13 colonies. And the Awakening actually awakened millennial hopes of America as a chosen nation. Jonathan Edwards and many of his day were post-millennialists. They believed that a massive movement of God's Spirit would transform the nations before the second advent of Christ. And America might indeed lead the way if she could achieve that dream of being a Puritan city on a hill, a beacon of light for all the nations to follow. But the Awakening was not the only movement to shape the early history of our nation. The Enlightenment ran concurrently with the Awakening and produced a spirit of rationalism and anti-supernaturalism that also ran through the colonies. The Enlightenment eroded confidence in the authority of God's Word. Philosophy replaced theology as the medium through which to study the principles of science, law, government, and religion. And deism replaced the theism, the Christian theism of the Awakening. And what is deism? Well, deism is a minimalistic religion that was conditioned by our Christian heritage in the West, but also rejected core doctrines of Christianity, including the inspiration of the Bible, the deity of Jesus Christ, and the bodily resurrection of Jesus in particular, and of course, the second coming. Ethan Allen was not just the founder of a furniture store. In fact, he didn't found a furniture store. He was the hero of Fort Ticonderoga. He was an outspoken deist. His work, Reason, the Only Oracle of Man, avowed natural religion and attacked the priestcraft of the Bible. The eloquent pamphleteer Thomas Paine, perhaps the most popular and influential voice calling for revolution, was in fact a deist. His Age of Reason was an exposition of deism. Elihu Palmer believed deism should be institutionalized as a formal religion and organized the Deistical Society of New York. And such thinkers exercised real influence on many of America's founding fathers, including George Washington, James Madison, Benjamin Franklin, and especially Thomas Jefferson. Now, given the influence of both the Great Awakening and the Enlightenment, and I'm oversimplifying, was America founded as a Christian nation or a deist nation? Scholars really debate this. And this, frankly, is the question that Christian nationalism, which I addressed last week, fails to address. This confusion between deism and Christianity is what makes vocal historians like David Barton so incredibly dangerous. Was America founded as a Christian nation or a deist nation? I'm reminded of an incident in the life of Carneades, who I mentioned last summer to you. He was an ancient skeptic philosopher who lived in Athens. He rose to the leadership of Plato's Academy, and he was later sent as an ambassador to Rome. And there he delivered two lectures on the nature of Roman justice. On the first day, he argued that Romans were the most just people in the history of the world, only to return the following day and argue the Romans were the most unjust people in the history of the world. Well, good arguments could support both propositions. The Romans emphasize ethics, natural law, and political jurisprudence. My students read Cicero to this very day with profit. The Romans were also brutal conquerors and forged an empire on the anvil of war. They enslaved millions of people and indulged in spectacles of murders in their wicked gladiatorial games. So were they just or unjust? Well, I wonder what Carneades would do with the question, was America founded as a Christian nation? Could you, in fact, produce evidence for the fact that yes, we were, or for the fact that no, we weren't? In his book, Nature's God, Matthew Stewart writes, many historians take for granted that the reference in the preamble of the Declaration of Independence to, quote, the laws of nature and nature's God amounts to a gesture of conventional piety. Religious conservatives today routinely celebrate it as proof that America was founded as a Christian nation. But then he continues, yet nature's God properly belongs to the radical philosophical religion of deism. It refers to nothing that we commonly mean by the term God, but rather to something closer to nature. So that raises a very interesting question. How do you distinguish between an evangelical and a deist? The very simple answer to that question is this: who is Jesus? When you embrace God without embracing the divinity, the atonement, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you are a deist. In God we trust will not do. You must also trust in God's Son, Jesus, if you are a Christian. Thomas Jefferson removed references to Jesus' deity and the resurrection from his Bible. He was no Christian, despite David Barton's efforts to make him into one. So what really happened in the American Revolution? It is rather complex, and I want to just embrace this complexity today, ultimately with a view to helping us become better citizens of our beloved country. Some Christians have an idyllic view of colonial churches collectively taking up arms and just throwing off the anti-Christian government of England to go out and found a Christian nation. But reality, as you might have guessed, is far more complex. As far as Christianity goes, it's really difficult to say whether England or America had a greater per capita Christian population in 1776. Christian population in 1776. Remember, England also had recently experienced the Great Awakening. John Wesley, George Whitefield had seen a great awakening over in England. And many Christians at the time of the Awakening, at the time of the Revolution rather, really struggled with the application of Romans 13. Some ministers promptly returned to Europe and simply refused to join the revolution. Others were drawn into the chaplaincy. In doing so, they left their churches abandoned. And some ministers participated in the actual combat. They would preach a sermon and go get their hunting rifle and go to war. Church membership actually declined, both during and after the war. Colleges, many of which had been founded to train preachers, were shuttered. Their dormitories were used for military purposes. Their faculties were dispersed. And this led to a shortage of ministers in the years following the war. You really don't see a recovery until you get the Second Great Awakening. After the war, the political distractions surrounding the formulation of a new government kept Christians preoccupied more with the affairs of the nation than the church. And social unrest in the form of popular rebellions, like Daniel Shea's rebellion, often disrupted the church. And this situation actually called for a second great awakening. And the Lord graciously sent our country a second awakening. But the Revolutionary War was actually fought during a spiritually dark time in American history between the First and the Second Awakening. Again, the First Awakening ran from approximately 1734 to roughly 1745. The Second Awakening began around 1790. It began in the colleges and ran until the early 1840s, if you can believe it. In other words, 1776 fell in the middle at the nadir between the two awakenings. And churches during this period, during the war years, fared differently. The Anglican Church suffered a devastating blow because of its association with the English crown. Methodism likewise suffered. John Wesley was fiercely opposed to the revolution on the basis of Romans 13. And most of his preachers simply went back to England, with the exception of Francis Asbury, who went into virtual exile during the war years, and after the war, he actually was used mightily to recover the fortunes of the Methodist Church. Presbyterianism weathered the revolution fairly well and began to experience slow and steady growth thereafter, and it was really aided by the increased immigration of the Scots-Irish who were coming over. Baptists likewise weathered the revolution, and Baptist polity was rather compatible with the spirit of democracy that swept the colonies. And like the Methodists, Baptists grew exponentially during the Second Great Awakening. Also, denominations that were not associated with the English nation weathered the war fairly easily. For example, the Dutch Reformed or the German Lutherans had little difficulty moving to the war years because they didn't have the strong association with the English crown anyway. In other words, the revolution doesn't fit into these nice, tidy little categories as the Christian nationalists would have us to believe. Few, if any, Christians in 1776 viewed themselves as launching a new Christian nation by gunning down the British. You simply don't find that in the sources. Nevertheless, Christianity grew rapidly in the new country, especially during that Second Awakening. And that rapid growth has led many to assume the country was actually founded as a Christian nation. I mean, here's the founding, and then boom, this great awakening. But again, I want us to be careful to embrace the complexity so that we really do become responsible citizens. Thomas Kidd, who I mentioned last week, is one of the better evangelical American church history scholars working today. I'm jealous because Dr. Dunn actually knows him, and we have a mutual admiration for Kidd's work. Well, Kidd, in my estimation, does a masterful job of working through the complexity. Read Kidd, don't read Barton. All right, Kidd's book, God of Liberty, A Religious History of the American Revolution, I think, in my opinion, is one of the best sources that you can read on the American Revolution. And Kidd identifies five areas of agreement between deists and evangelicals that were evident at the time America was founded. And at the expense of turning this into a history lecture, All right. I do want to work through all five because they really do speak to the complexity of America's birth. Five areas of agreement between deist and evangelicals. Number one, deist and evangelicals believed in the disestablishment of churches. In other words, no state church. Deists like Thomas Jefferson and James Madison and evangelicals like the famous Baptist preacher John Leland, who knew Madison, agreed there should be no state church in America. Here's why. For Jefferson, he didn't want the church controlling the state. He was no friend of Christianity, of course. Likewise, Leland did not want the state controlling the church. And so they agreed. We can have no state church. Let's leave the two separate, which I think was a great idea, by the way. Number two, deists and evangelicals agreed a creator God guarantees fundamental human rights. For the deists, political liberty was granted by God, not the monarch. All men are created equal, Jefferson declared, and they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, which I happen to agree with. Now, even though evangelicals differ with Jefferson over their belief in the deity of Jesus, they really did wholeheartedly agree with Jefferson on this point. In fact, many, though certainly not all, many Christians just took this truth and pushed it much further than the founding fathers. Many Christians insisted on the immediate and the complete abolishment of all slavery. They said, look, if all men are created equal, then you must end slavery immediately. The Second Great Awakening actually produced numerous Christian reformers calling for an end to black slavery and Indian genocide. Now, unfortunately, the influence of slaveholders like George Washington and James Madison and Thomas Jefferson prevailed. And in fact, the twin evils of slavery and genocide led to another century of war, of Indian wars and a great civil war. But there was agreement that, in fact, all men are created equal. Now, how that was applied looked very different depending on your view of slavery. Number three, deists and evangelicals recognize human sinfulness. Deists do believe that humans are sinners. And consequently, they saw centralized government power as dangerous. Preachers of the First Great Awakening were generally Calvinists. They were Calvinists in their understanding of the total depravity of mankind. And their theology would profoundly affect colonial America. Now, the founding fathers typically did not share the Calvinist doctrine of original sin and total depravity. Nevertheless, as James Madison put it in Federalist Paper 51, men were not angels. So both evangelicals and the politicians came to believe that a separation of government powers is necessary to preserve our liberties. And I agree with both. Fourth, both deists and evangelicals insisted a republic needs to be preserved by virtue. You need good citizens. Hardly a virtuous man himself, Benjamin Franklin insisted on the need for civic virtue. If political sovereignty is given to the people, then those people must be virtuous, law-abiding citizens. Franklin really did understand this truth, but so too did all the Christians. The Second Awakening gave rise to numerous institutions which actually promoted ecclesiastical and civil piety. Institutions, Christian institutions that labored for the betterment of society. And number five, both deists and evangelicals believed that God's providence worked in and through nations. There was a new sense of optimism that permeated America in the aftermath of the Revolution. Against all odds, the revolutionary cause had won. Well, perhaps God was raising up America for some great special purpose in the world. Perhaps America really could become a city on a hill. But as I mentioned last week, there was really no consensus, and is to this day, no consensus on what exactly a city on a hill is. Is that a land full of churches from sea to shining sea? That was the Puritan vision. One great country full of churches and believers. Is that a land full of lush farmlands and sprawling plantations? That's how Jefferson saw it. Is it a land full of wealth and prosperity built by capitalism? Is it a land fortified by an impregnable military? What exactly is a city on a hill? What exactly is a Christian nation? Now, these 5 points demonstrate that America's Christian heritage is really quite complex. Again, we're dealing with 3 million people. That's what makes it so complex. If we were dealing with 2 people, it'd be a lot easier. 3 million people. Now, these 5 truths guaranteed 2 other truths. Number 1, religious freedom. And number 2, the separation of church and state. Those truths are just built into the fabric and structure of our country. And I actually am a staunch supporter of both. Religious freedom and separation of church and state. Now, it's easy to gloss over the fact, though, that these freedoms were not evenly applied. America's black population would not enjoy anything resembling religious freedom for an astonishing 200 years. As late as the 1960s, even many churches were resistant to the idea of integration. And in 1776, the long war with the Native Americans, which had begun with the Puritans and the Pilgrims a century earlier, was far from over. More than a century of bloody wars was required to build America to its present size. These included the Cherokee Wars, Northwest Indian War, Tecumseh's War, Creek War, Seminole War, Texas Indian Wars, Black Hawk War, Texas Revolution, Mexican-American War, Apache Wars, Navajo Wars, Paiute War, Dakota War, Red Cloud War, Comanche War, Sioux War, Nez Perce War, and Cheyenne War, among many, many others. It wasn't like everything was said and done in 1776. In 1776, you had 13 colonies. You didn't have 50 states as you have them today. There was a lot of war still to come. And by the way, the Bill of Rights in 1776 was not there. It took a long time to bring the Bill of Rights to its present size. So with all that in mind, let's return to our question, was America founded as a Christian nation? It's a question I wrestle with every year in my graduate church history class when we work through American church history. And this is what we can say. We can indeed celebrate America's freedoms, her democracy, her generosity, her pioneer spirit, her Christian heritage, and her world benevolence. We can celebrate her great awakenings, her missionary enterprise, her Christian schools and publishing houses, and tens of thousands of American pulpits aflame with the gospel through the centuries. And if that's all that you emphasize, together with the positive influences of the founding fathers, well, you might make a case that America was founded as a Christian nation. But as Christians, we also have to lament America's terrible legacy of slavery, the destruction of Native American culture and peoples, the willful abortion of our children, which didn't begin with Roe v. Wade. It goes all the way back to the beginning of our country. We have to lament the global export of violence and pornography in the name of entertainment. Many, many Islamic countries hate America today because of all the pornography that comes from America. When we examine our founding documents also, for the name that is above every name, Jesus Christ, who was enthroned as ruler of all nations at the resurrection, friends, do we find him? Do we find the name Jesus Christ in our documents? Here's how I embrace the complexity. I don't want to speak for Dr. Dunn, but we had a conversation about this a while ago, and I think he and I are on the same page, but America was founded with a profound Christian influence. But it goes too far to say that America was founded as a Christian nation. Look at Dr. Am I okay, Dr. Dunn? I think so. Okay. Very good. That's a well appreciated yes. All right. With a profound Christian influence. But I think it goes too far to say America was founded as a Christian nation. Frankly, is there any such thing as a Christian nation in the church age? Friends, let's look at every verse in the New Testament that tells us how to go out and build a Christian nation. Are you ready? Okay, we're done. Well, let's turn again to Matthew 5, where we left off last week, and let's really try to achieve some real balance in our thinking. We want some real balance in our thinking about this. Matthew chapter 5. Beginning with the Puritan governor John Winthrop, politicians including John Kennedy, Ronald Reagan, and Barack Obama have referred to America as a city on a hill. But none of them actually used the phrase in the context in which Jesus used it. Jesus said in Matthew 5, verse 14, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Friends, Jesus was speaking of his disciples shining the way to God the Father in heaven. That's the context. He was speaking of our individual light shining before our fellow man to point them toward a full restoration with their Creator. In the same sermon, Matthew 6 and verse 19, look at the text, Jesus told us to live with a heavenly perspective. "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal." Now friends, I believe in capitalism, the original Adam Smith version. But the Sermon on the Mount was not designed as a manifesto on American capitalism, teaching us how to build a wealthy, prosperous nation. That really was not Jesus' focus. His focus is on his own kingdom, the kingdom of heaven. That's where Jesus' mind is. Now, in verse 33, Jesus gave us his priorities. Seek first the kingdom of God. That's where Jesus' mind goes. And if you'll turn to Matthew 24 and then Matthew 28, you will discover that Jesus' mind really runs 180 degrees opposite from the direction of the notion of Christian nationalism. And I'll come to Matthew 24 momentarily. But let me again return to the idea of Christian nationalism, which I began discussing last week. Christian nationalism often views America as a kind of new Israel. Whereas Israel was the object of God's special attention and affection in the Old Testament, clearly there was one nation that he singled out in the Old Testament. Well, America now occupies that privileged position. But is that really what the New Testament teaches, that one nation is going to replace Israel? The Puritans often referred to America as Israel or the Promised Land. And that's where the spirit of Christian nationalism began. But unfortunately, as I pointed out last week, they often used the notion that they were God's chosen nation as an excuse to exterminate the Native Americans. Like the Canaanites and the Amalekites who inhabited the Promised Land during Joshua's day, well, the Native Americans are now ripe for destruction. And last week, I quoted a 1689 sermon from the Reverend Cotton Mather, who was one of the most respected Puritan pastors, who called for nothing short of Indian annihilation. He actually called for the extermination of the Indians. Now, mercifully, not all Puritans agreed with Mather. After seeing hundreds of defenseless Christians, his own converts, mercilessly destroyed by the Puritan colonists, missionary John Eliot wrote to the Puritan authorities, and here's what he said. When we came, we declared to the world that the endeavor of the Indians' conversion, not their extermination, was one great end of our enterprise in coming to the ends of the earth. My humble request is that you would follow Christ's design in this matter, to promote the free passage of religion among them and not to destroy them, to send them away from the light of the gospel. They actually were sold into slavery down the Caribbean. To send them away from the light of the gospel, which Christ hath graciously given them, unto a place, a state, a way of perpetual darkness, to the eternal ruin of their souls, is to act contrary to the mind of Christ. To sell them away for slaves is to hinder the enlargement of Christ's kingdom. Now, Eliot really understood God's purpose for the present age is to enlarge his kingdom among every tribe and tongue and nation. Jesus never promised to build a single Christian nation, but to claim a kingdom out of every tribe and tongue and nation. That's the mission of the church. And look at Jesus' statement in Matthew 24 and verse 14. Jesus said, this gospel of the kingdom will be proclaimed to the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. That's Jesus' focus. Now, the word nations refers to every ethnicity and tribal group. But this is how Jesus envisions the future of his kingdom. Jesus does not see one nation. Rather, Jesus sees the gospel of his kingdom pressing its way into all nations. That's his mission, and that includes America. Now turn to Matthew 28. The words of the Great Commission are really quite familiar to us. But have we really thought about them in the context of Christian nationalism? Does Jesus ever command his followers to go build a Christian nation? No. Here's what he commands. Verse 19. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. Friends, we are called not to build a nation. We are called to disciple the nations. Now, let me clarify, because I know you have a question. Am I saying that there's no role for Christians in politics? That's not what I'm saying. I believe that Christians should be involved in politics. I wish we had more Christians involved in politics. I am very grateful for Christians in positions of influence in Washington. I am grateful for the crystal clear salvation testimony of Senator Tim Scott. He spoke in chapel last semester, and it was just so incredibly moving to hear his testimony of salvation. I really believe that being a city on a hill means we don't go out and create one nation, but we shine our light in every vocation, in every place. We need Christians everywhere, permeating every vocation in every realm of society. But friends, if you believe in the Great Commission, and if, in fact, you lived in a Christian nation, you would have to leave. Right? I mean, how could you possibly obey the Great Commission if you're surrounded by believers? You'd have to go somewhere else. And this was John Eliot's larger point. The Puritans wanted to create this shining city on a hill, a Christian commonwealth full of believers. That was their mission. We're going to go out here and build a society that's going to be full of Christians. Well, that experiment, noble as it was, turned into an ecclesiastical and political disaster. In the halfway covenant, the Puritans began admitting believers into their churches, admitting people into their churches who were not even true believers. They didn't know what to do with these people who never embraced the faith. And here they are, they're supposed to be part of the Christian nation, but they're not embracing the faith. So we'll bring them sort of halfway into the church, or sort of halfway in and halfway out. What does that mean? The halfway covenant. And in King Philip's War, fought between the Puritans and the Indians at the end of the 17th century, a third of the Puritan population was wiped out. And roughly 75% of New England's Native American population, 75% exterminated during that war. That war, hardly known today, was exponentially more deadly than any war in American history, King Philip's War. Far more deadly than any other war. It was fought between the Puritans and the Indians. It was fought over this issue of whether you can go out and build a Christian commonwealth. Well, what do you do with unbelievers? What do you do with Native Americans around you who don't convert? Well, if you're not part of the Christian commonwealth, we have to exterminate you. It was a total disaster. So friends, let me give you four reasons why I think we have to be very careful to reject Christian nationalism, and I'm not doing so to discourage you on July 4th. Quite the opposite. I want to do so that we can really encourage each other to be theologically informed, responsible citizens in this great country that the Lord has given to us. First, when we embrace Christian nationalism, we often ignore or endorse America's past sins. Take, for example, the issue of racism, which manifested itself both through black slavery and Native American genocide. If you just glamorize America's past as wholly Christian, you will tend to downplay the problems of the past. I grew up in Colorado when I first came as a student to South Carolina in 1996. I ran into some very interesting people. I had barely arrived before I met several Christians who literally told me that slavery was the means by which God wanted Africans to be evangelized. Christians who told me this. Friends, that's the tortured logic of Christian nationalism. You find a way to justify everything in the past. Friends, as Christians, we have to just speak truth to the nation. Yes, America was founded with a profound Christian influence, but America was also born in original sin. Slavery arrived before the pilgrims. So let's just keep our focus where Christ put it. Christians are not called to build a nation, but to be light in every nation. And that leads to a second truth. When you embrace Christian nationalism, you pressure Christians to endorse everything the nation does. America can never do any wrong. Every war started, every bomb dropped, every cause she endorses must somehow be good. But as Christians, our duty is never to embrace everything our nation does. Our duty is to call our nation to continual repentance. That is the duty of every Christian. And that is why the preachers of the First and Second Awakening were so influential. They called their fellow Americans to repentance. Friends, Israel was loved by God. Dearly loved by God. But God never endorsed everything Israel did. Her national prophets called her constantly to repentance. In fact, Israel had to be called to repentance from the moment the nation was born. God had no sooner delivered his law from the heights of Sinai above than the people were worshiping a golden calf in the valley below. Christian nationalism tends to view the whole period of American history from the pilgrims to the Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the original Bill of Rights, as this kind of Christian golden age back there. But friends, there never was a golden age in America or Israel or in any nation. We've all had our golden calves, every nation. And the golden age, friends, was lost in the Edenic Rebellion at the beginning of human history. And it will not be restored until the new creation. That's when you're finally going to get the Christian Commonwealth. That's when you're finally going to have that beautiful city on a hill when New Jerusalem comes down to planet Earth. And until that time, Christians are called just to be salt and light in every nation. Thirdly, when you embrace Christian nationalism, every election becomes a choice between good and evil, God and Satan, Christ and Antichrist. And given those binary perspectives, it's really difficult for Christians to speak about evils in both parties. It's like, why do I have to side 100% with one side or the other? Can't I just speak truth? And fourth, when you embrace Christian nationalism, you discourage the next generation. This, I think, is really critical. Christian nationalists just live in this perpetual state of misery and doom. We were once a Christian nation, they claim, and ever since we've just fallen down into utter darkness. Well, do you know how young people respond to that messaging? It's all over, we've given up, the good old days are all in the past. You know how people respond to that? They just totally reject it. Wouldn't it be better to simply tell the truth? Christians have always been called to resist the evils of this nation. And God has a long, long record of accomplishing extraordinary things through Christians in this nation. Think of Jeremiah Everts, a product of the Second Great Awakening, which swept to the campus of Yale through the preaching of Jonathan Edwards' grandson, Timothy Dwight. Everts was a young man during those days and came under conviction and came to Christ. Well, Everts went on to become a stalwart evangelical champion of Indian rights and a constant thorn in the flesh to Andrew Jackson and his Indian removal policies. That's Christianity. Teach your children to become Jeremiah Everts, not to despair for a Christian golden age that never existed anyway. That's how you disciple the next generation. And I really believe that we love our country more, not less, by telling the truth. Patriotism does not blindly endorse everything a nation does. Patriotism does not accept a skewed view of history. Patriotism simply speaks truth to the nation. I know I'm going long, but would you turn to Romans 9? And let me just show you how patriotism, or love for country, is modeled by the Apostle Paul. I want us to be very positive in the end. I'm trying to be balanced, but I want to end very positively. The application of Romans 9 just struck me with incredible force when we were working through Romans. Now, one caveat, in Romans 9 and elsewhere, Paul speaks of Israel both as an ethnicity and as a nation, but the application is really the same. In verse 1, Paul says, "I am speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience bears me witness in the Holy Spirit that I have great sorrow and unceasing anguish in my heart. For I could wish that I myself were accursed and cut off from Christ for the sake of my brothers, my kinsmen according to the flesh. They are Israelites." Friends, those are words of astonishing and supreme love. Love for his own people. Now, Paul was called as a missionary to the Gentiles. But how often do we find Paul observing Jewish feasts and customs? Even when the new covenant no longer required them? Isn't that interesting? Why does Paul celebrate his Hebrew culture? How often do we find him returning home to Jerusalem? How often do we find him grateful for his Jewish upbringing? The apostle to the Gentiles maintained a surprising loyalty to his own people and to his own nation. And notice how Paul emphasizes his love three times. I'm speaking the truth in Christ. I am not lying. My conscience bears me witness in the Holy Spirit. Paul really emphasizes this. And Paul also calls both Christ and the Spirit as his witnesses. Paul loves Israel. Now, of course, Paul condemned Israel. Paul condemned Israel's national sins. Nevertheless, when you read from Romans 9 through 11, you can't possibly conclude that Paul is somehow unpatriotic. He wishes himself accursed from Christ for the sake of his fellow Israelites. So here's the point. It is appropriate, entirely appropriate, to feel genuine love for your own tribe and native village and countrymen. Friends, I love our national anthem. I have been to Fort McHenry several times. I've actually lost count. I love America's diverse culture. New Jerusalem is going to be diverse. I love America's great museums. I have been to Washington, D.C. and the Smithsonian Museum. I don't know how many times. I have in-laws that live up there, in case you're wondering. I go down there all the time. I love reading America's history. I am rereading Tyndale and Shy's classic two-volume set, now in its 10th edition and used by college professors all over the place. It's a great read. This last week, I began reading Simon Winchester, the man who united the states, America's explorers, inventors, eccentrics, and mavericks, and the creation of one nation indivisible. Great book so far. Never read it all. I've read primary sources going all the way back to the Pilgrims. They're really delightful. Friends, I love America's beautiful landscapes and national parks. My boys have national parks posters all over their room. They're really, really great. I like to go to all of them sometime. Probably won't have a chance before I die. I have been, I think, to 15 foreign countries, and I always love coming home into my own. And I'm grateful that our country has come a long way from the evil days of slavery and genocide and segregation. I condemn it. It was evil. But I do not go so far as to hate my country because of her past sins, like so many are doing today. Paul never hated Israel because of her past national crimes. He never went so far as to hate his country. By the way, anyone remember the interview with Kobe Bryant in 2008 before the Summer Olympics in Beijing? Anyone remember that? I went back and found it last night. Kobe Bryant, I don't know why I brought this up. He gets this great interview before he plays for the American basketball team, and he says he got his uniform out and put it on the bed and just stared at it, and such an honor, he said, to represent my country. It was so moving. Go Google that sometime. Not now. Kobe Bryant, 2008. It's a Chris Collinsworth interview. I want to show that to all the Olympians before they go. All right, watch this. All right, and stand for your flag. All right. Friends, we don't have to go to an extreme that tells you all good citizens must hate their country. That's not Christianity. Paul loved Israel. Yes, he wept over Israel, just as Jesus wept over his beloved Jerusalem. But Paul loved Israel, and Jesus loved Israel. Alexander Solzhenitsyn, despite the evils of communism that invaded his native Russia, still loved his country. Solzhenitsyn was thrown into the gulag for some 11 years for speaking out against Stalin. And when Solzhenitsyn was finally exiled to America, American Christians profoundly misunderstood him. They thought, oh, he's going to be very critical of Russia. He's going to be on our side. What they didn't understand is that he loved his country. He hated what communism was doing, but he loved his country. You ought to. It is entirely appropriate for Chinese citizens to love China, for Egyptians to love Egypt, for Mexicans to love Mexico. It is entirely appropriate for Americans to love their country and to seek its redemption. It is entirely appropriate to love people who look like you and speak your language and share your culture, not to the exclusion of everybody else, but it is entirely appropriate to love your people. And do you know why? Here's why. Because the King of Kings loves all nations and tribes and tongues. If Jesus can love my nation and my tribe and my English tongue, well, then I can too. Thank you very much. Jesus, friends, has a redemptive interest in all the nations. And Revelation 21, I'll probably come back to this in a couple weeks, tells us the nations, get this, will bring into the New Jerusalem their glory and their honor. What does that mean? The word glory in this instance refers to the uniquenesses of a nation or a people or a culture. Don't buy into this unscriptural notion that a future one-world government is going to obliterate all national distinctions. The Bible teaches no such thing. Rather, the gospel will go on redeeming the nations until the end, Matthew 24. And the glory and the honor of the nations will pour into that heavenly city, adorning the new earth, looking like a shining city on a hill. So friends, there is no question that Paul loved the Gentiles who were not part of his culture. And I love all cultures. But it's equally clear that Paul loved the Jews whose culture he shared. To despise your own nation in the name of political correctness is sin. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you that you have placed us in this nation where we have so many freedoms. and such a great heritage. And teach us, Lord, to look back on our past and to repent of our sin. And to look to the future, Lord, and to pray for the redemption and the restoration of our fellow men and women across this great nation. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, can we take just a moment and prepare our hearts for communion? If you did not get the elements, please feel free to go out in the lobby and get them at this time. But just as we look back on the history of our country and we see things that need to be repented for, we see evil in the history of our country, look into your own heart. You'll see the same truth there. You'll see evil. You'll see things that need to be repented from. So can we take a moment and do this? Examine our own hearts. Call your own heart to repentance. And go on serving Christ in His kingdom. We prepare to take the bread. We'll we are going to go back sometime soon to passing the plates, but we have about 800 of these cups. So we had two different people order more, not knowing the other one was ordering the cups, so we're using them up. All right, let's pray for the bread. Thank you, Lord, for the broken body of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord, that as we look back on the history of our country, that we find thousands and millions of Christians who have celebrated this table across all 50 states, going all the way back to the earliest days. And Lord, we rejoice that collectively we will partake of this table in the new world with redeemed saints from all through the history of our country and people through the history and the countries of the entire world. We look forward to that day, and it's in preparation for that great wedding supper of the Lamb that we partake. Amen. As far as I know, the first communion was celebrated in 1607 in this country. Robert Hunt was a minister, and he came over with the Jamestown settlement in 1607, and his job was to pastor a bunch of men. There were no women in that original group, and when they landed in Jamestown, one of the first things they did is tacked up an old sail between three trees, and they got an old piece of lumber from the church, and they tacked it up between a couple trees, and that was his pulpit. And they had a Sunday service there, and they had communion in 1607. Robert Hunt, so far as I know, the first pastor ever to have communion in the New World. It goes all the way back to 1607. And did you know that communion was also celebrated on the moon? I think it was Buzz Aldrin who took communion to the moon with him, but that's another story. Let's give thanks for the blood. Thank you, Lord, for the shed blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we pray, Lord, that the shed blood of Christ would come to cover a multitude of iniquities in this great nation. Lord, this nation needs you. We need you and the shed blood of Christ more than anything else. We pray that your shed blood would come to be applied to sinners all across this country today. We pray for Christ's sake. Amen. The hour is late, so John will come and do our hymn. And can we just start our 11:15 classes at about 11:20? Will that work for everybody? 11:20? Give you a little time to get your coffee in between. And again, if you're here with us visiting, feel free to come back tonight. We hope to see all of you tonight. Many, many thanks. Let me just say many thanks to Brother Ben Pierce now. We're all together for going to all the work to buy the meat and get it prepared and grilling. I know several are helping him, but this was his idea. He emailed me, I think, about 2 months ago, and I said, we got to make this happen. He volunteered to do this, and I said, let's do this. This will be great. So we're really, really excited. Come back tonight, 5 o'clock, out here in the field, and we'll just have a wonderful time together.
Would you stand with me as we again sing of the power of the cross?
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the cross, Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of gold. This.
bless you. You are dismissed.